Hi there, I'm Jeremy Krug and welcome to my 10-minute review of Unit 2 in AP Chemistry, which covers the structure and properties of molecular and ionic compounds. Please hit that thumbs up button, subscribe to my channel, leave a comment, and share this video with your friends. Let's get started. In chemical compounds, the two main types of bonds are ionic and covalent. We normally say ionic bonds are between a metal and a nonmetal, and while covalent bonds are between two nonmetals. Usually, ionic compounds are brittle, they have high melting points, and conduct electricity when dissolved into solution. On the other hand, covalent compounds have lower melting points and don't conduct electricity very well when dissolved. We can further classify covalent bonds as a polar covalent and nonpolar covalent. If one of the atoms in the bond is hogging the electrons, we say it's a polar covalent bond. On the other hand, if the two atoms are sharing those electrons equally or almost equally, we say it's nonpolar. To determine if a bond is polar or nonpolar, look at the difference between the two atoms' electronegativities. If the two values are very close to each other, they will be nonpolar. If they're farther apart, we'll say it's polar. Now, since you don't get an electronegativity chart on the AP exam, you'll have to rely on how close the atoms are to each other on the periodic table. For example, selenium and iodine are close, so we'd predict their bond to be more nonpolar than selenium and oxygen, which are farther away from each other on the table. That bond would be more polar. Energy of bonds has a lot to do with how atoms interact with each other. Generally speaking, the farther away from each other two atoms are from each other, the higher their potential energies are. The two atoms in a chemical bond tend to locate near one another so that their potential energies are as low as possible, and that's what determines bond length. Bond order is just another way of saying single, double, or triple bonds. First order bonds, single bonds, are the weakest and the longest, while third order bonds, triple bonds, are the strongest and the shortest. Double bonds are somewhere in the middle. Coulomb's law helps us decide how strongly ions will interact with each other. Remember, Coulomb's law has two variables, charge and distance. The greater the magnitude of charge, the stronger the attractions will be between the ions. So a magnesium ion with a +2 charge and a chloride ion with a -1 charge will have a fairly strong attraction, but magnesium is even more strongly attracted to the sulfide ion because sulfide has a -2 charge. So we can say that magnesium sulfide will have a higher melting point than magnesium chloride. The larger an ion is, the weaker its attraction will be to surrounding ions because its protons are so much more distant than any neighboring ion. So magnesium and sulfide have a strong attraction, but magnesium is even more strongly attracted to oxide because the oxide ion is so much smaller than the sulfide ion. So we'd say that the melting point for magnesium oxide is even higher than it is for magnesium sulfide. So look at charge first, then if it's a tie, check out the distance, the relative size of the ions. You need to know the nature of ionic compounds. Sodium chloride is ionic, which means it's made up of sodium cations and chloride anions. But that doesn't mean that an individual NaCl unit is just floating around independently. All ionic compounds are part of a repeating three-dimensional crystal lattice. Sodium chloride looks more like this. Be able to draw this and understand that for the most part in the crystal, the positive ion is smaller and the negative ion is larger. Metals are bonded differently. Metallic elements exhibit what we call metallic bonding, where the valence electrons are delocalized and can basically float around. So there are all these positively charged metal ions surrounded by a sea of electrons. The mobility of those electrons helps explain why metals conduct electricity so well. Now, different elements can combine with metals to form alloys. When most of us think of an alloy, we think of something like bronze or brass or pewter. Those are substitutional alloys. These are where atoms of one element substitute into positions of some of the atoms of the primary metal in the alloy. So for example, in brass, zinc atoms substitute into the positions where some of the copper atoms are, and it looks like this. Now, some alloys have a metal with much smaller atoms that stick themselves in the spaces between the atoms of the metal. Here's an example of that. This is called an interstitial alloy. Now, steel is the best example of this. Little carbon atoms stick themselves into the interstitial spaces between the iron atoms. Lewis electron dot diagrams are visual representations of the molecular structure of a molecule. So if you have this arrangement of atoms and are asked to put the dots in, I would recommend that you always start with the outside of the molecule and work your way in. So remember that hydrogen is stable with two valence electrons, and the others are usually trying to have an octet. So hydrogen brings in one valence electron, so one for each of these. The oxygen on top brings in six dots, and so does this one over here on the right. The carbon brings in four dots. Now, the way this is drawn, the carbon in the middle only has six dots, and it needs eight. So I'm going to move a pair of dots from the oxygen down to the middle, just like this. And now that puts a double bond between the carbon and the oxygen here. So we can draw this with lines representing the pairs just like this in our Lewis electron dot diagram. Normally, molecules are most stable when their atoms all have eight valence electrons. Of course, hydrogen can only hold two, and boron tends to be stable with six. Sometimes, the only way to make a Lewis structure work is to give the central atom more than eight valence electrons. When that happens, it's called an expanded octet, like in xenon tetrafluoride here. When we put the eight dots around xenon, we try, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, and we find that we run out of room for xenon's last four dots. So those extra dots end up being placed as unshared pairs on the central atom, just like this. Sometimes there's more than one acceptable way to draw a Lewis diagram. Let's say you're trying to draw the structure for ozone, which has the formula O3. You might draw it like this, or you might draw it like this. The double bonds are in different positions, but both structures are fine. These are called resonance structures. You need to be able to determine the formal charge of any atom in a molecule. To calculate formal charge, just take the number of valence electrons an atom has based on its location on the periodic table, then subtract the number of electrons assigned to it in the Lewis diagram, counting each bond as a one. So for example, in ozone, on the first atom, oxygen has six valence electrons. Then we subtract for the dots, 1, 2, 3, 4, and there are two bonds here, so that makes six, so that equals 0. 6 minus 6 equals 0. Then on the second atom, we have 1, 2 dots up here, and then there are three bonds, 3, 4, 5, so that makes 5. 6 minus 5 equals positive 1. On the third atom over here, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and there's one bond, so that makes 7. So 6 minus 7 equals negative 1. The total of the formal charges in a structure should equal up to the total structure's charge, and it does here in this structure. And usually, but not always, in a neutral molecule, the most stable Lewis electron dot diagram will have every atom with a formal charge of 0. You also need to be able to apply the VSEPR theory. Make sure you can count the number of sigma and pi bonds in a molecule. Every single bond is a sigma bond. Every double bond is composed of one sigma bond and one pi bond. And every triple bond is composed of one sigma bond and two pi bonds. You need to be able to determine the hybridization of any central atom in a molecule. Just take the number of sigma bonds on that atom and add in the number of unshared electron pairs touching the central atom. So if the number is 2, like it is here, the hybridization is sp. If the total is 3, like it is here, you'll choose sp2. And if it's a 4, like it is in this molecule, the hybridization is sp3. You need to know the molecular geometries and bond angles for molecular structures. For example, if a molecule has 4 sigma bonds and no unshared pairs on the central atom, it has a tetrahedral shape, and its bond angle is 109.5. Now, the AP readers are normally a little bit more lenient on bond angles than most classroom teachers, so the bond angles they generally expect you to know are 109.5 degrees, 120 degrees, 90 degrees, and 180 degrees. Here's a more complete list of those molecular geometries and bond angles. That was Unit 2. I'm Jeremy Krug. Join me next time for my 10-minute review of Unit 3, so we can review some more AP Chemistry together.